हेलो, आई एम डॉक्टर कौशल किशोर सिंह, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर एट SNPIT एंड RC उमरा बावेन बारडोली गुजरात। सो टुडे वी विल डिस्कस द टॉपिक ऑफ फ्लूइड फ्लो ऑपरेशन लाइक विस्कोसिटी एंड न्यूटन्स लॉ ऑफ विस्कोसिटी एंड द वेरिएशन ऑफ विस्कोसिटी विद टेम्परेचर एंड अदर थिंग्स आर लाइक कंटिन्यूस ग्रेविटी डिकेंटर्स and hydrodynamic equilibrium. So all these things we are going to discuss in this video. So now we will see kinematic viscosity. So what is the kinematic viscosity? So in MKS and SI system, the unit of kinematic viscosity is meter square per second or meter square second. So while in CGS unit it is written as centimeter square per second. So all these units and the detailed definition we have discussed in previous lecture. And kinematic viscosity is just the ratio of dynamic viscosity divided by the density of that particular fluid. So now we will see the Newton's law of viscosity. So what is the Newton's law of viscosity that we will see here? So it states that the shear stress tau on a fluid element layer is directly proportional to the rate of shear strain. So the constant of proportionality is called the coefficient of viscosity, and mathematically it is expressed as given by equation tau is equal to mu du upon dy. So here mu is the proportionality constant and it is known as a viscosity. So fluids which obey the above relation are known as Newton's fluid, and the fluids which do not obey above relation are called non-Newtonian fluids. So now we will see variation of viscosity with temperature. So temperature affects the viscosity, and the viscosity of liquid decreases with the increase of temperature, while the viscosity of gases increases with the increase of temperature. So this is due to the reason that the viscous forces in a fluid are due to cohesive forces and a molecular momentum transfer. So in liquids, the cohesive forces predominates the molecular momentum transfer, and due to closely packed molecules and with the increase in temperature, so the cohesive forces decreases with the result of decreasing viscosity. But in case of gases, the cohesive forces are small and molecular momentum transfer predominates. So with the increase in temperature, molecular momentum transfer increases and hence viscosity increases. So the relation between the viscosity and temperature for liquids and gases are, so this is in case of a liquid, mu is equal to mu naught 1 upon 1 plus alpha t plus beta t square. So here mu is the viscosity of liquid at T degree centigrade in Boyle, and mu naught is the viscosity of liquid at 0 degree centigrade in Boyle, and alpha beta are constant for liquids. So for water, mu naught is equal to 1.79 into 10 to the power minus 3 Boyle, and alpha is here 0.03368 and beta is 0.000221. So this equation shows that with the increase of temperature, the viscosity decreases in case of liquid. And now we will see for in case of gases. So this equation for gases, mu is equal to mu naught plus alpha t minus beta t square. So here for air, mu naught is equal to 0.000017, so 0.4017, and alpha is equal to 0.0780, like 56, and beta is equal to 0.1189 into 10 to the power 9. So this equation shows that with the increase of temperature, viscosity increases. So this is the reason why viscosity is increasing, because in case of gases, gases are closely packed and in a closed container, so there if you will increase the temperature, then the molecules will collide and they will increase the viscosity. In case of liquid, if you will heat the liquid, then the viscosity will decrease of that liquid. So now we will see the two examples of the viscosity. So like water flows between two plates of which the upper one is stationary and the lower one is moving with a velocity v. So what will be the velocity of the fluid in contact with the upper plate? So this is just the example of Newton's law of viscosity. And with that, here 4 points are given. So this is MCQ multi-type question and one is correct. So here we will see the explanation. Here answer is zero. So according to the no slip condition, the relative velocity between the plate and the fluid in contact with it must be zero. So thus the velocity of the fluid in contact with the upper plate is zero, and that with the lower plate it is V. Now we will see the second example. So the viscous force and the relative motion between the adjacent layer of a fluid in motion. So which one of the following fits best in the sentence? Like opposes, never affects, facilitates, may affect under certain conditions. So now we will see the explanation. So answer is A, opposes, and explanation is viscosity is the internal friction of a fluid in motion. So it is the property by the virtue of which the relation relative motion between two adjacent fluid layer is opposed. So now we will see the pressure. So how this, what is the pressure and how it affects the liquid? So pressure is defined a normal force exerted by a fluid per unit area, and we speak of pressure only when we deal with a gas or a liquid. The counterpart of pressure in solids is normal stress. So since pressure is defined as force per unit area, it has the unit of newtons per square meter, and which is called a pascal. So that is 1 pascal is equal to 1 newton per meter square. So the actual pressure at a given position is called the absolute pressure, and it is measured relative to absolute vacuum, absolute zero pressure, and most pressure measuring devices, however, are calibrated to read zero in the atmosphere, and so they indicate the difference between the absolute pressure and the local atmospheric pressure. So this difference is called the gauge pressure. So now here we will see P gauge can be positive or negative, but pressure below atmospheric pressure are sometimes called vacuum pressure and are measured by vacuum gauges. So that indicates the difference between the atmospheric pressure and the absolute pressure. So absolute gauge and vacuum pressure are relative to each other by this P gauge is equal to P absolute minus P atmospheric, and P vacuum is equal to P atmospheric minus P absolute. So now we will see pressure at a point. So pressure is the compressive force per unit area, and it gives the impression of being a vector. However, pressure at any point in a fluid is the same in all directions. So that is, it is has magnitude but not a specific direction, and thus it is a scalar quantity. So this can be demonstrated by considering a small wedge shaped fluid element of unit length delta y is equal to 1 into the phase. So in equilibrium, as shown in this figure, the mean pressure at the three surfaces are this on these surfaces. So the we can just mean pressure in surfaces. So and the force acting on the surface is the product of mean pressure. So here pressure is a scalar quantity and not a vector. So the pressure at a point in a fluid is the same in all directions. So here this is the pressure gauge, and this is the wave if we are applying, and here this is the liquid is filled. So this is the pan and piston. So if this piston will come down due to the pressure, and this is the liquid, so liquid will try to come out here, so here, from here. So at this point this will act as a, this oil will act as a source of pressure. So this is your cylinder. So likewise this pressure gauge is working, and this is the example. So a dead weight gauge with a 1 cm diameter piston is used to measure pressure very accurately. So in a particular instance, a mass of 6.14 kg including piston and pan brings it into balance. So if the local acceleration of gravity is 9.82 meter per second, then what is the gauge pressure being measured? So if the barometric pressure is 748 torr, so what is the absolute pressure? So now we will see here solution. So the force exerted by gravity on the piston, pan and weights is F is equal to mg, is equal to 6.14 into 9.82 and 60.295 newton. And gauge pressure is F upon A, force per unit area. So this is the force and area has been calculated here, and this is the answer. So the absolute pressure is therefore this 76.77 plus 748 and multiplied this. So finally it is coming 86.74 newton per centimeter square. So now we will see another example. So what is the pressure in Pascal at a depth of 1 meter below the water surface? So we will see here explanation. So answer is this here, and it's the summation of weight on top of the water surface. So in this case, it is the weight of atmosphere and water above 1 meter. So this is the formula: P depth is equal to P atmosphere plus density of water into gravitational constant into depth. So according to this will be calculated, then it will come 98,100 Pascal. So we will see another example. So which among these devices are the best suited for the measurement of high pressure liquids with high accuracy? So dead weight gauge, vacuum gauge, magnine wire pressure, and ionization gauge. So just we will see the explanation. Here magnine wire gauge, pressure gauge is the answer. And magnine wire is the most suitable measurement device for high pressure liquids. So it has a high stability and durability on a long term basis. So it also has a high hydrostatic pressure sensitivity and low strain sensitivity. Now we will discuss about the hydrostatic equilibrium. So we will see the basic ideas, and the principle of hydrostatic equilibrium is that the pressure at any point in a fluid at rest, so where hydrostatic is just due to the weight of overlying fluid, and as pressure is just force per unit area, so the pressure at the bottom of a fluid is just the weight of a column of the fluid. So one unit of area is cross section. So the principle is simple to apply to incompressible fluid such as most liquids, for example water. And note that water and other common liquids are not strictly incompressible, but very high pressures are required to change their densities appreciably. So if the fluid is incompressible, so that the density is independent of the pressure, so the weight of a column of liquid is just proportional to the height of the liquid above the level where the pressure is measured. So in fact, the mass of a unit area column of height h and density rho is just rho h, and the weight of the column is its mass time, so the acceleration of gravity g, but the weight of the unit area column is the force it exerts per unit area at its base. So the pressure, so P is equal to rho gh. And for example, the density of water is 1000 kilograms per cubic meter, and so the weight of a cubic meter of water is 1000 kg per time, and the acceleration of gravity 9.8 meter per second square, or 9800 newtons. So this force is adjusted over 1 meter square, so the pressure produced by a 1 meter depth of water is 9800 pascals. So the PA is the SI unit of pressure, equals to 1 newton per square meter, and the unit of pressure used in atmospheric work on earth is the hectopascal. So 1 HPa is equal to 100 PA. So the pressure 1 meter below the surface of water, ignoring the pressure exerted by the atmosphere on top of it, is 98 HPa. Now hydrostatic equilibrium. So standard atmospheric pressure is 1013.25 HPa. So it takes 1013.25 divided by 98, and it is 10.33 meters of water to produce a pressure of 1 atmospheric. So that's about 34 feet for those who like obsolete units. So the pressure in the ocean increases by about 1 atmosphere for every 10 meters of depth. So the average depth of the ocean is about 4 kilometers. So the pressure on the sea floor is about 400 atmosphere. So now we will discuss about the continuous gravity decanter. So in this figure it is shown, and this continuous gravity decanters are used for separating the two liquids. So a gravity decanter of type shown in this figure used for continuous separation of two immiscible liquids of differing densities. So we can separate two liquids if they are having the different densities, otherwise we cannot separate by this method. So the feed mixture enters at one end of the separator. So this is your feed mixture, and the two liquids flow slowly through the vessel, separate into two layers, and discharge through overflow lines at the other end of the separator. So this is just the other end, light liquid outlet. And provided the overflow lines are so large that the frictional resistance to the flow of the liquid is negligible, and provided they discharge at the same pressure as that in the gas space above the liquid in the vessel. So the performance of the decanter can be analyzed by the principle of the fluid statics. So for example, in the decanter shown in this figure, let the density of the heavy liquid be rho A and that of the liquid rho B. So density, just we have here defined, it is different. So the depth of the layer of liquid is ZA and that of the liquid ZB. So the total depth of the liquid in the vessel is ZT. So this is ZT, is fixed by the position of the overflow line for the light liquid, and heavy liquid discharges through an overflow leg connected to the bottom of the vessel and rising to a height ZA2 above the vessel floor. So the overflow line and the top of the vessel are all vented to the atmosphere. So it is here, and light liquid is coming here and heavy liquid is coming here, and this is coming into the atmosphere. So here, since there is a negligible friction resistance to the flow in the discharge line, so the column of heavy liquid in the heavy liquid overflow leg must balance the leads to the equation ZB rho V plus ZA1 rho A1. So ZA2 rho A. So ZA1 is equal to ZA2 minus ZB rho B upon rho A. And solving this equation, so total depth of liquid vessel is ZAT, ZB plus ZA, and it comes ZA is equal to ZA2 minus ZT rho V upon rho A and 1 minus rho V upon rho A. So with this equation, you can find out the ZA. And this equation shows that the position of the liquid interface in the elevation this is just the T is equal to 100 mu upon rho A minus rho V, and here T is the separation time, and rho A rho V densities of liquid A and B kg per meter cube, and viscosity of the continuous phase is Cp. So here we can see this example. A horizontal cylinder continuous decanter is to separate 1500 dBL per day and 9.93 meter cube per hour. So of a liquid petroleum fraction from an equal volume of gas acid. So the oil is the continuous phase and at the operating temperature has a viscosity of 1.1 centipoise and a density of 54 LVF upon FT cube, 865 kg per meter cube. So the density of the acid is 72 LVF upon FT cube and it is 1153 kg per meter cube. So compute A, the size of the vessel, and B, the height of the acid overflow above the vessel flow. So here we will see the answer. The vessel size is found from the separation time, substitution this equation, so that just we saw above. In there we will put this value and it will come 0.38 hour. Now we will calculate it for this 23 minutes, then it will come like this, and the total liquid hold up, it will come like this. So the vessel should be about 95% full. So its volume is 2014 divided by 0.95 and it is 2120 gallon or 8.03 meter cube. So the length of tank should be about 5 times and its diameter, 8 tank 4 feet 1.22 meter in diameter and 22 feet 6.1 meter long would be satisfactory. So with standard disc heads on the ends, its total volume would be 2124 gallon, and the fraction of the tank volume occupied by the liquid will be 95%, and for a horizontal cylinder this means that the liquid depth will be 90% of the tank diameter. So thus ZT is equal to 0.9 into 4, it is 3.6 feet. So if the interface is heavy, is halfway between the vessel floor and the liquid surface, so ZA is equal to the 1.8 feet, and solving this, so the height of the heavy liquid overflow gives ZA to 1.8 and to 1.8 plus 3.6 minus 1.8, 54 divided by 72, so finally it will come 0.96 meter. So successful operation of a decanter depends on both the sedimentation and the coalescence of that dispersed phase. So equation 2. That above equation gives poor result if the liquid to be separated are not clean but contains particulates or polymeric film that reduce the rate of coalescence. Such contaminants may also lead to the formation of a dirty layer of unsolid droplets called a red at the liquid-liquid interface. So coalescing devices such as beds of porous solids, membranes or high voltage fields are often necessary for a satisfactory separation. So with cleaner liquids, the size of a decanter can often be greatly reduced by the putting in horizontal or slightly inclined pipes or flat plates so that the heavy phase droplets need to fall only a short distance before reaching a layer of the heavy liquids. So this is the finally we have discussed in this video lecture. Thank you.